If, like me, you've struggled to stay consistent posting on social media, when you do post, you want it to have maximum impact. And one of the most powerful ways of doing that is through carousel posts. Based on last year's research, carousel posts have almost twice as much engagement and more than twice as many views as static posts. Apart from just the additional engagement and additional likes, there is another reason that carousels are so effective for Instagram. One of the things that the Instagram algorithm looks for is how long people spend time on your account. And with a carousel, people tend to spend more time looking at your post because they're scrolling through your carousel slides. So they stay longer, and the Instagram algorithm registers that as showing more interest in your content. The other reason is that because you have multiple slides in a carousel, even if people scroll past your first one without engaging with the carousel, as they scroll down the feed, your second, third, and other subsequent slides will actually appear in the feed further down. So you have multiple chances to make an impact and get people to actually see your content. So today we're going to look at some best practices for creating carousel posts for Instagram, and I'm actually going to take you through step by step how I create a beautiful, scrollable carousel post in Canva. So first, a quick note about post sizes on Instagram. Now, when most of us think about Instagram, we think about the little grid of squares, and Instagram posts used to always be square. And the size for that was 1080 pixels across by 1080 pixels high. That was the kind of standard size for Instagram posts for many years. But not so long ago, Instagram gave us the option to be able to post vertical posts. That meant that they were just taller than they are wide. And the size for those is 1080 pixels wide by 1350 pixels high. Now, there's a couple of reasons for using that size for your posts and carousels. First of all, it takes up more of the screen real estate, which just gives you more space to work with. You can make more of an impact with visuals, you can fit a little more information on it, and it just gives you a little bit more space to get your message across. The other reason to use that size is that when you're scrolling through the Instagram feed, if you come across a post that's square-sized, you can actually see the post below it peeking out. So it kind of encourages you to keep scrolling and see what's next. If you use the vertical size post, because it takes up more of that screen real estate, it tends to just be the image that you've included and then your caption or comments that are peeking out underneath. So it kind of encourages people to stay on your post and engage with it rather than scrolling on to see what's next. So that's the size that we're going to use for our carousel today. 1080 pixels wide by 1350 pixels high. So the first thing that we want to do is create the canvas or the artboard for our Instagram carousel. Now, for my carousel today, I'm going to have an end slide, a beginning slide, and then four slides in between. So it's six slides in total. And there are two ways that we can create this carousel. We could create it as a series of single slides. So in Canva, we would just create one size slide and then duplicate that and design each one individually. Or what I prefer to do is to have a carousel that looks like it's one long scrolling image. So to create that, we're going to create a custom-sized artboard in Canva, and then at the end of the design, we're going to split it up into individual slides. To figure out what the dimensions of that artboard are, all we have to do is work out the width. The height we know is 1350 pixels based on Instagram's preferred size of vertical post. And so to work out the width, we're just going to say it's got to be six slides, and they're going to be 1080p each. So six slides at 1080p each means that we have to have a single large artboard of 6480 pixels wide. And in case you were wondering, I did that maths with a calculator because numbers scare me. So to create our artboard in Canva, we're going to go to the custom size button and we're going to enter in those dimensions that we just worked out. So it's a width of 6480 pixels, a height of 1350 pixels, and we're going to say create new design. And you'll see that it now gives us this long scrolling artboard, which we're going to split up into individual slides. Now, to make it easy for ourselves, we want to make sure we know where each slide starts and ends. And to do that, we're going to use a handy tool in Canva called their guides. If you go to File and then go to View Settings, we can ask it to add guides. Now, one of the default settings here is actually to add six columns. So I'll click on that And you'll see it adds 6 slides, but they've got a bit of a gap between each of them. So to customize this, or if you have more than 6 in your artboard or in your carousel, you can go to Custom, and you can tell it how many columns and what the gap needs to be. So I'm going to change the gap to 0, click Add Guides, and now you can see I have 6 slides markated by these guides so that I can see exactly where each one starts and ends. The other thing I like to do is, because your first slide is going to be cropped to a square on your grid, I want to make sure that there's no important information or weird cropping happening when it is cropped to a square on your Instagram grid. So I'm going to put in a couple of guides at the top and bottom so that I can see where that kind of safe zone is. And the way I'm going to do that is just to cheat it by putting in a square onto my artboard. I'm then going to drag it to the left-hand side of that first slide. I'm going to hold Shift and then click and drag the corner so that it constrains the proportions. And then just make sure that that square is in the middle of this artboard. Once I'm sure that it's in the middle, I can then go up, hover over the ruler here, click and drag, and I can actually just drag 2 custom guides to where that block starts and ends. If I delete that block, you'll see that it now shows me where the safe zone is for my design on that first slide. It doesn't matter as much on the other slides because people will see them in the feed rather than in the grid, but it's good to know just in case you wanted to use them individually further down the line. So now we have our artboard and we're ready to start with the design. So the first thing I'm going to do is to change the color of my background. And I'm going to click on background color and then use one of the colors from my brand kit. Now, if you're not using a brand kit in Canva, I really suggest that you do so. It's incredibly helpful to have your colors and your fonts and even graphics and photographs built into that brand kit, easily accessible. It makes it so much quicker and easier for you to design consistently and to stay on brand. Now, in the free Canva account, you're a little limited as to how much you can have in your brand kit, but on the Canva Pro account, you can have as many as you like and even create multiple color palettes. If you want to try out a Canva Pro account, just have a look in the description below this video, and there is a link for a 30-day trial so you can try it out for yourself. So I'm going to choose this pale neutral color as a background for my slides, just so that it's still light, but it gives me something to work with. Now let's talk through the process of how I build a carousel like this. So I normally start with the last slide because that's going to be the final slide in the carousel, and that's usually where you will have a call to action to try and get people to take some kind of action or engage with you. For this particular carousel, I just want people to engage with the post, to try and get some activity on my Instagram account. So to do that, I'm going to drop in some icons that I found in Canva, and then a couple of text boxes which I'm going to customize just to prompt people to take action. I've put a background color and a little box to draw attention to the content, and then I've added my branding, my logo in at the bottom, and just these icons that we've come to recognize as the icons that encourage interaction on Instagram. The next slide that I'm going to create is the first slide, and that's going to have my main title and my main hook. Now, obviously with a carousel, the first slide is incredibly important because that's how you hook people in. So it either has to be something very powerful visually, or it has to be some kind of text, some kind of copy hook that gets people really intrigued and excited, or makes them curious to explore further. So for mine, I'm going to start with a very simple statement and just highlight a couple of words, and I'm going to put a background behind that for the first slide. So you can see the first and last slide kind of frames the carousel. Now the next thing I want to do is to kind of get this feeling of the whole thing being one long flowing image rather than individual slides. And to do that, I'm just going to extend the background from the first slide and add a graphic element of the edge of a paper so that it kind of brings it into the second slide. So rather than just having an individual first slide, it feels like it's moving into the second one, and it kind of intrigues people and gets them to move along once they see that it extends to the second slide. Once I've done that, all I'm going to do is drop in a couple of text placeholder boxes for the content that I've already drafted. So for the first one, I'm going to just drop in a heading, 3 bullet points, and then I've also got this little embellishment of a text script that I use, and I'm going to use that to highlight that this is number 1 of 4. And then you can copy and paste those placeholders into the other slides, and it makes it much easier than creating from scratch with text boxes on every slide. I will just add in text boxes and those numbers onto the other 3 slides, and I'll then customize the copy with copy that I've prepared before. Once I've done that, I always like to have simple layouts, but I like to include some elements that feel human. So that's one of the reasons I use the script font sometimes, and I use it as embellishments. So for this one, I'm going to add in a couple of script elements that just make it feel a little more human. So a couple of underlines, a couple of hand-drawn circles, just to kind of start to add a little more interest to it. The next thing I want to do is to add in some visuals or some imagery. To start with, I just put in some placeholders of where I think imagery could work. Once I've done that, I can see that I've extended a few of them to cross over the boundary of slides so that, again, it introduces that idea of it being a single flowing image, and it kind of makes people more inclined, it invites them to scroll along this long image. Once I've got the placeholders in, I can then use the stuff that we've talked about before in terms of finding images and elements and also consistency in your designs, which I'll link to above in this video. And I'm going to introduce some of those elements into this design, just using Canva's library and some of the images that I've uploaded. You can see I've used an image of myself in the first one, kind of in soft focus, but it makes it a bit more personal, and that's why I wanted to include that. I've also included a kind of watermark of my branding, which is very subtle and doesn't crowd things, but makes sure that I've got some branding presence halfway through the carousel. And then just a couple of elements that again feel sort of hand-drawn or feel like they introduced a little bit of imperfection, which I like to include in the minimal designs. Once I've done that, I'm then going to go in and just do a final introduction of a few elements, again, just to bring in that kind of human feel and also to highlight some key points. And you'll see that I've actually used white for most of these so that they're very subtle, but when you see them at a decent size, they do have a presence. And again, they just introduce a little bit of interest, and crossing the border between slides again intrigues people and makes them want to scroll along to see what's next. So once you're happy with the design, the next thing we're going to do is to just export your image. You'll go to Share and then choose Download, and download it in a PNG or a JPEG format as one wide image, which we're then going to split up to use in a carousel. Now, there are a few ways that you can actually split up this image or crop this image to use in a carousel. There are a lot of phone apps or programs that you can use on your computer just to create a size and crop it to those individual slides. The other way you could do it is to just use your actual Photos app on your phone and just import the image to your phone, drag it along, and crop where those individual slides end. Now, just as a tip, if you're going to be doing it manually, you want to make sure that you're getting those crops right. So what you can do when you do your design is to just include a very, very subtle colored line where the divider of each slide is. You could even just have a tiny line at the top and bottom, just to act as crop marks so that it's easy for you to see where to cut those slides. Somebody might notice them, but largely they'll go unnoticed if you crop them directly on the line, and it just makes it easier for you to know where to crop that image. Another way that you could do this is to actually do it in Canva, and I'll show you how we do that quickly. So this is just a single page in Canva, and it's sized to an Instagram vertical post, so 1080 pixels wide by 1350 pixels high. And the first thing I'm going to do is to upload the image that we just exported. Once I have the image imported, what I'm going to do is to just click and drag it onto this artboard. I'm then going to resize it so that it fits from top to bottom, and then I'm going to scroll along to fit the first slide. Now, there are two ways that you could create the other slides. The first would be to duplicate this page and then click and drag that box along until you find those crop marks or where your second, third, fourth slides begin and end. But another way to do it, if you want to be really accurate, is to use the positioning tool. And what I mean by that is we will click on this image, we'll go to position at the top, and then you'll see here there is an X value, which basically just means where this image is along the X or the horizontal axis. And to move it along, we're just going to move it in increments of 180 pixels. And because we're moving it to the left, we're going to use a minus value. So for the first one, it will be minus 1080 pixels. We hit enter, and that's your slide number two. We could then duplicate this page, go to the X value, and change it again, which would be minus 2160 pixels, which is twice 1080 pixels. And that's your slide number three. We could just carry on and do this for the remaining slides, and as long as we put in the correct values into that X value, we will have perfectly positioned slides that are easy for us to then export as individual slides to upload to Instagram. So there you have it, an Instagram carousel of 6 slides which we can then share and download as individual slides and upload those to your phone or to your Instagram scheduler, and you can then post it directly to your Instagram. Just another tip is if you want to include some animated elements or even a video in one of those placeholders, this is where I would suggest that you add it in this final stage before you export the individual slides. That way you could export those slides that have moving images or moving elements on them, but export them as an MP4 video. Because in Instagram, you can upload a combination of images and videos as part of the same carousel. And that way you can add even more interest on individual slides rather than just having a single video on a single post. I would love to hear if this was helpful to you, and also if there are any other tutorials or any other subjects that you'd like me to do some tutorials on. So please drop me an email. My email is on the screen right now, and let me know what would be of use to you so that I can plan, make sure that's included in my content calendar for the rest of this year. Another favor I have to ask is if this is helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you would sign up for my weekly newsletter. You can do so by going to the link that's on the screen right now or in the description below the video. It's called Meaningful Creations, and every week it goes out with some personal insights, design tips, as well as introducing you to some meaningful creators that are creating really beautiful things and giving you a bit of insight into some of the creative processes of people all over the world. Again, I hope this has been really helpful. Thank you so much for being here. Have a fantastic week, and I'll see you next week.